awesome God we have. Amen?
Amen.
Title this morning is Walking in the Light. How many think it's a good idea to walk in the light?
Yes.
Yeah. But we get in trouble when we walk in the dark, don't we? It is good to walk in the light. That's the title for this morning. But not just any light. How many know we need to walk in the light of the Lord? Amen. Walk in His light. Let's ask the Lord now. Lord, we thank You and praise You this morning that we do not have to walk in the darkness. We can walk in the light, Your light, the light of Your Word, and the light that Your Spirit shines upon our hearts. We thank You and praise You this morning. We're grateful for the time of worship together, exalting Your name as our Savior, our God, mighty to save. We thank You that we can follow You and pursue You with all our hearts, that we can walk with You in the light of life, and we praise You this morning. Lord, we ask in the next few moments, You'd encourage us from the Scripture. You'd be working our hearts by Your Holy Spirit, accomplishing what You desire. So, Lord, we thank You for today. We're grateful, Lord, for this opportunity to worship and look into Your Word together. Lord, help us to walk in Your light. Help us today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, our opening text is going to be in James chapter 1. Last Sunday, I had this all planned out. It was all just really, really good. And then we had snow. And guess what we did last Sunday? We canceled church. Yes, I hated to do it, but it was the right thing to do. But it ruined my great opening for last week. Because last week in the morning, I was going to open with the idea that in the evening, we were going to have the super wolf blood moon. Anybody recall that from last Sunday night?
Yes.
Now, super because the moon was at a very close peak to us, which made it look big. Wolf because it's the first full moon of the new year. They call it the wolf moon for the howling of the wolves or something like that. And then it was a blood moon because it was having the total eclipse, in which case it was turning the reddish color. And so last Sunday night, if you stayed up to watch it, somewhere around midnight or something, you got to see the moon turn pinkish red, and we had our super wolf blood moon last Sunday night. And I was going to open up last week with the idea of the light and the sun and the moon reflecting the light and the shadows and all that. I had that all worked in for the opening last week, and we didn't get to come. I was like, oh, Lord. I mean, a full moon with a full total eclipse on a Sunday. But, you know, there were people that were saying it's a sign of the end times. And if you recall, in the prayer meeting the week before, I said, I don't really think it's a sign of the end times. Because in the Scripture, the full moons that were signs, or the eclipses, were couched in catastrophic events that were happening. And we have not seen those catastrophic events yet. So I think what we have is just a very exciting, beautiful thing. And I actually watched it. I watched the shadow move across. I thought this was so cool. I know our God, our Creator God, set the moon, the planets, the stars, the orbits, the timing. What a great God we have. Amen?
Amen.
And I just got to watch that shadow. And then just before it turned red, the clouds rolled in. Oh, I even went outside. It was like below zero. It was cold. And I stood there watching the clouds hide my eclipse. I was eclipsed by a cloud. Man, I thought, you know, how do you sleep after something like that? You know?
You went to Canada to see it.
Yeah. Oh, I tell you what, it was, anyhow, how many of those things happened, right? But, you know, I don't think it was a sign. I just think, other than the fact that we have an awesome Creator who has set these things in motion, and we want to give thanks for that and praise Him for that. Folks, the signs are coming. There's some around us, and there's some graphic ones, but that was not one last Sunday. It was just very beautiful and interesting. If we got to see it.
Yeah.
So anyway, the verse that kind of led me toward that thought is here in James chapter 1, verse 17. 1:17, James writes, "Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like the shifting shadow." So that variable list of shifting shadows that we have. How many know God is good? And we have so many blessings, do we not?
Amen.
And there's blessing upon blessing. There's so many blessings. Even in the hard times. How many have discovered that God is good even in the hard times? Yes. But what James is telling us here is that in the if you look at these things, he's the Father of lights. He not only blesses us, but he doesn't change like the shifting shadows. He's not inconsistent in his character. You know, there's a few thoughts. I had three T words for this. The first is that he's true. He's true in his character. He's true in his word. You can count on him. That's the second word, was trust. Because he's true, you can trust him. How many are glad for that? He doesn't shift around and move around. The eclipses do, other things do. How many have been out and shadows have come across stuff? Shifting shadows and so on. God doesn't have shifting shadows in his character. God is true, thoroughly true within his own being, and so we can trust him. And that is vitally important for us to know that he is true in his character, and so he's trustworthy. We can trust God. But the third key is when we let his light shine into ours, into our hearts, he transforms us. Because just as light can push out the shadows, when we let his light shine into our hearts, guess what he does? He begins to change. How many are glad that you are not the same person you were before Christ got a hold of you? Anybody glad for the transformation? Amen. Paul spoke of it this way, Romans 12. Remember what Paul said? Do not be conformed to the world. Do not be in the shape. Don't let the world shape you. Do not be conformed to the world. Rather be transformed by the renewing of our minds. You see, God, as the Lord takes up his residency within us and his word and his Holy Spirit, he begins to change us from the inside out. He begins to renew our minds, giving us more and more that mind of Christ that we need so we can live transformed. How many want to be transformed in Jesus? And so we can have that. He is true, he is trustworthy, and he transforms us. I want the light of God to shine more brightly in my heart. How about yours? How about you? Amen? And so this is the thing as we begin this morning in James, that God is the Father of heavenly lights. There's no shifting shadows. He's dependable, true, trustworthy. And when you let him shine in your heart, he transforms you, making us more and more like Jesus Christ. However, that's the great goal we have. Amen? Now, you're in the back of your New Testament. Go a few pages over to 1 John chapter 1. The title this morning is Walking in His Light. You know, in 1 John chapter 1, verse 5, you have to talk about our fellowship with Jesus and the fellowship with each other. Verse 5, 1 John 1, 5, this is the message we have heard from him, and we declare to you, God is what? God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. See, there's no sin in him. There's no inconsistency in him. God is light. In him there's no darkness, no variableness, no shifting shadows at all. Verse 6. If we claim we have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, what's the danger? We're lying and we're not living by the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies, cleanses us from all sin. How many love that verse? Now, how many discovered that there's times when we mess up? There's times when we blow it. There's times when we say things we ought not, do things we ought not. There's times when we sin. For all have sinned and fall short, short of the glory of God. Right? So look at verse 9. If we claim we're without sin, we deceive ourselves and, verse 8, the truth is not in us. And now verse 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. How many glad it doesn't say half? How much trouble would we be in if God only forgave us of half our sin? How much trouble would we be in if he only washed us from half our sin? Anybody glad it says he is faithful and he'll just, what will he do? He'll forgive us and cleanse us of all our sin. And so now we can walk in the light because of Jesus Christ. He restores us to relationship with Him. He forgives and He cleanses. And guess what He does? He makes it possible to walk in relationship with Him, fellowship with Him, and we can walk in the light as He is in the light. How many want to do that more and more? Yeah, I want that more and more. I don't want to be in the shadows. I don't want to be in the dark. I want to walk in the light as He is in the light. Our big problem is we have a tendency to want to stay in the shadows. We have a tendency to want to walk in the dark. How about walking in the dark can be a dangerous place to walk? Now, we know that in the natural realm. What can you do when you walk in the dark? Stumble and fall. One of Christy's favorite things is, in our family as we were growing up, is that at night, I would turn off the light. Well, that makes sense. Well, then, of course, I'd either walk across the bedroom and you know, she'd be listening and she'd... We had a demonic bed leg. Do you know what that thing would do every night when I turn the light out?
Hit your toe.
Yes, it would. That leg on the bed would move out. Nobody would ever see it, but it would. And it would get right there so that I would park my toes on that bed leg.
Wow.
That's why it was just a demonic bed leg, I'm telling you. In the dark, it would try to make me stumble. And then Christy would hear, oh, and I'd hear her laugh. You know, the crazy thing is we had a couch with that middle leg in the front. Anybody ever had one of them?
Yeah.
That's another demonic leg. Do you know what that leg does when you walk? That leg will just come out from under the couch and attack your toes. I don't know how that works or why that works, but how many know when you walk in the dark, there's things that will trip you up? Am I right? And that's why it says we need to walk in the light as He is in the light. It's the light of Jesus that we need to walk in. As soon as we walk in some other light, our own light, or the light of the world, that is really dark, and we'll stumble and we'll fall. We need only one light. It's the true light. It's the light of Jesus Christ. And we need to walk in the light of the Lord. That's where we need to walk. But if I say I'm walking in the Lord, but I'm walking in darkness, what did John just write? You're lying and you're not living by the truth. And so if I've got to get out of the darkness and really walk with the Lord. And so if I say, well, I want to walk with the Lord, but I'm going to play in the shadows, I know that's a dangerous way to approach life. And so the call of the Lord to us is don't play in the shadows, but walk in the light. Amen? Because that's where we won't trip and stumble and fall. I want you to turn with me. John also wrote the Gospel of John. So go all the way back to John chapter 1. John chapter 1. First chapter of the Gospel of John. He begins by opening up and exalting Jesus as the Word, the Logos, the revelation, the knowledge, the wisdom of God, who was with God and was God. He affirmed the deity. The wonderful mystery of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Exalts the Lord as the Creator, and He's made all things. Paul said the same thing, that all things were made by Him and for Him. And so He exalts Him as Creator and the revelation of God. Further down, He reveals that He's talking about Jesus Christ when He said, this one was made flesh and dwelt amongst us and is the only begotten of the Father. But pick up with me, if you would, in verse 4. John chapter 1, verse 4. He's talking about Jesus. And He says, in Him was life, and that life was what? The light of men. The light shines in the darkness. And the darkness has not, some say, understood, or some say have not overcome it. And that's the idea, is that it hasn't taken hold of it to suppress it and destroy it. How many of the darkness cannot do that? The darkness cannot overcome and suppress the light. I want you to know the light of Jesus is still shining today. Amen? As much as the enemy is against the Lord and against the Word of God and trying to suppress the light of Jesus is still shining in people's hearts and lives today. Amen? The darkness cannot and will not win. I illustrated a couple of weeks ago. In fact, we were talking about it in Sunday school this morning. Remember I told you about those dark pine trees with their fingers reaching up? And the images, I sat there looking at it. The morning star was right there. And it looked like those dark fingers were trying to grab the morning star and pull it down. How many know it didn't happen? Because it couldn't pull down the morning star. Instead, the morning star gave what it promised. The sun rose in the dawning of a new day. Amen? And the enemy, as dark as he is, as nasty as he is, he may try to defeat Jesus, but how many know he does not win? In fact, you read the last chapter. In fact, you read the last book. Who wins in the end? It is Jesus who wins. King of kings and Lord of lords. And there may be some dark moments, and the enemy may have his dark reach out, but I want you to know he cannot overcome the light. He does not win. The light wins. Amen?
Amen.
So here's this light. And this light is shining. It shines in darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. It then goes verse 6. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. Now this is John the Apostle who's writing this, but he's not talking about himself. He's talking about John the Baptist, who had a ministry of preparing the way for the coming of the Lord. So John is writing this about John the Baptist. He said, he came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. See, John the Baptist was not the light. He came only as a witness of the light. Verse 9, the true light that gives light to everyone coming into the world. Who's the true light? Who is John the Baptist talking about?
Jesus
Christ. Man, later on in chapter 8, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. And so he's talking about Jesus Christ, the true light. Look at verse 10. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world what? Didn't recognize him. Now there were a few that did, but mostly what did the world do? Didn't recognize Jesus at all. Verse 11. He came to that which was his own. He came to the Jewish people from Galilee down to Jerusalem. He came to his own. But his own received him not. Now a few did, but by and large the nation what?
Refused
him. So verse 12. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right, the authority to become what? Children of God. How many want to be a child of God? How many want to be in his kingdom and in his family? Notice there's three words. I've pointed this out before, but every time I read it, I point it out. Believe, receive, and become. Everybody see those words? You got to believe in who Jesus is and what he did at the cross for your sins. That he died for your sins, becoming that Lamb of God, that sacrifice. You've got to believe in who he is and what he did. But he didn't stay dead. He rose again. He's the Lord of life. And as a risen Lord, he's our Savior. We have great hope and expectation and anticipation in him. You've got to believe who he is. But just believing with a sense of mental assent to it is not enough. You must receive him as the one who died for your sins. Receive him as the one who rose again. You've got to believe and receive. If you believe and receive, God takes care of the third. You become a child of God. How important is that, folks? Folks, there's nothing more important than that. That is the most eternally significant issue facing you, facing every single person. You've got to believe in who he is and what he did at the cross, and you've got to receive him. But when you do, you get to become a child of God. Hallelujah. I want to be a child of God. How about you? I want to be in his family. I want to be in the Father's house. Amen? And I just want to encourage you to do that. John goes on, if you were to keep reading, he goes on exalting the Lord. And he talks about how in Jesus Christ, he was full of grace and full of truth. He says he's the only begotten of the Father. He is the one, and as he says, and from his fullness we receive grace upon grace, gift upon gift, blessing upon blessing. How many want the grace and blessing of Jesus Christ? Then you must receive him. You must believe and receive. If you say no to him, you put yourself outside of that. I know that's a dangerous place to be. And so you've got to do what the New Testament tells you to do, what John tells you to do. Believe and receive, and God enables you to become. Notice nowhere in the Bible does it say, by religion, you can become a child of God. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, by philosophy, you can become a child of God. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that by your own will, you can become a child of God. I think I will just be good enough on my own. But all have sinned and fallen short. And so there's only one answer, there's only one hope. You've got to believe in who Jesus is. Receive him into your heart as your Lord and Savior. And then you get to become a child of God. Nothing else will do, and nothing else will work that for you. It's a faith response to Jesus Christ. Amen? And the Bible is full of encouraging us to do that. And so I encourage you today, put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. You're in John chapter 1. Go with me to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. Look with me if you would. Begin verse 4. Jesus just got done telling them about the Father's house. He's going to prepare a place for them in the Father's house. And verse 4, Jesus says, "You know the way to the place where I'm going." By the way, shortly after he says these words, right, he gets arrested and then crucified. But how many are glad he didn't stay dead? He rose again. But here he's talking about the Father's house. He's talking about going to heaven. He says, "I'll be coming back for you." And then he says, verse 4, "You know the way to the place where I'm going." So verse 5, Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way?" And Jesus answered him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Everybody say that. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. See, Jesus is the only way to the Father. He's the truth about it, and he's the life that enables us to have that life forever. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And I want you to consider that this morning. Now, Jesus, as the way, through the cross and resurrection, he has become the only way to the Father. Religion, philosophy, nothing else will do it. There's only one. It's Jesus. By the way, he said it emphatically. When he says, "I am," in the Greek text, it's actually, I am. Everybody say, I am. We don't talk about it, but he did. He said it emphatically. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes but by me. But how many are glad we can come by him? Believe, receive, and become a child of God. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." I want to make just a little application of this verse for you. The word "way" that is there in all these verses is the word "hodos." The word "hodos" means road, or way, or path. You know it from this. Ex-hodos. What was ex-hodos? Exodus. Ex is out. Hodos is road. Exodus was the road out of Egypt. You read that in the Old Testament. Now, the X isn't here. Jesus simply says, "I am the hodos. I am the road. I'm the road. If you want to get to the Father, if you want to get to the Father's house, what road do you take?"
Jesus.
"I'm the road." "Oh, no, all roads lead to God." That's not true. All roads lead you somewhere else. I'll show you in a moment. There's only one road that leads to the Father and Father's house. And that road is Jesus Christ. You need Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. William Wetzler painted a picture. You're probably all familiar with it. And I'll show you the scripture that kind of bears it out in just a moment. But he shows a picture of a plateau or two paths. In fact, there's variations of the picture. And lots of people moving. And then there's this big chasm. On the far side of the chasm is this beautiful city. We would know it from the Bible as the New Jerusalem, the Father's house. And people are moving along, and they fall off the chasm. They've entered the chasm, except for some who take a path, and they get on the cross because there's a bridge over the chasm shaped like a cross. And there's a few that don't go off the edge. Instead, they walk on the bridge of the cross to the Father's house. How many of those variations of that picture? Where did he get the inspiration of that picture from? Let me show you. Turn back with me to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. Jesus spoke these words. It was in the Sermon on the Mount. But Matthew chapter 7, go down to verse 13 and 14. Enter through the narrow gate, For wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to what? Destruction. That's a word that talks about the devastation that comes, the ruin that comes when you reject the Lord and end up in hell. Leads to the destruction, and many enter through it. But verse 14, but small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Notice what he chose in this illustration. He says, listen, there's a narrow road, there's a narrow gate and a narrow road, but there's also a broad way, and there's a wide gate. Many go on the broad, wide gate, but where does that lead to? Where does that broad road take you? To destruction, to hell. It takes you away from God. You miss God. But he said, but there's a narrow gate. Interestingly enough, in John chapter 10, you don't need to turn there, Jesus says, I am the gate. But here he said, I am the road. Isn't that me? In John 10, he's the gate, and John 14 is the road. And so when you go through the gate of Jesus, what road are you supposed to walk on? The road of Jesus. The narrow road. But what does the world want you to walk on? Broad is the way. Wide is that gate. Interestingly enough, that word wide that's translated there is plateia. We get plateau from it. And if you think of the imagery that's used, you think of a high plateau and people walking up. What happens when you get to the edge of a plateau? See, that's where the inspiration for the painting came from. And Jesus says, broad is the way. Oh, the world, the nation, that's why very few in John 1, most of them, they didn't recognize him. Why? They were walking on the broad road, the broad path. But what happens when they get to the end? Folks, whether you're strolling on it or running full speed ahead, you still go off the edge. But there is a narrow gate. Jesus said, I am the gate. There is a narrow road. Jesus, I am the road. Said, I'm the only road to the Father and the Father's house. How serious is that? We live in an age when everything around us is saying, oh, no, no, broad is the way. Broad is the way. You can live any way you want. You can behave any way you want. You can do anything you want. And when you look at the philosophy of this age and the philosophy of this world, it's a broad path and a broad thing. You can go, everything is fine, don't you worry about it. But look at the condition of our world. Look at the condition of our culture. Don't buy into it. The broad way does not lead you to the Father. Only the narrow way of Jesus Christ leads you to the Father. The broad way will lead you where you don't want to go. We need to walk with Jesus. Amen? We need to walk on the narrow way that he's called us to. Now, I know what happens sometimes. I go through the gate, I want to walk one road, one foot on Jesus' road, one foot on the Broadway, one foot on Jesus' road, one foot on Broadway, one foot on Jesus' road, one foot on Broadway. If I take another step, I'll be embarrassed. What happens if you try to walk both roads, folks? It's a shameful kind of thing, isn't it? But the enticement of the enemy, the enticement of the world, is that you would buy into the broad road, and that even if you want to name the name of Jesus, go ahead and name the name of Jesus, but keep your feet on the broad way. And I want you to know the word of the Lord is you cannot use his name, claim the narrow way, and walk the broad way. Now, I'm not saying we save ourselves or our works save. Our works will never save. For by grace are you saved through faith. But folks, there's something wrong if you think, well, I can name the name of Jesus, but still live in the way that's going to destruction. I can name the name of Jesus, but walk the broad path of self-interest and self-things and world pursuits and all of that. Look where the world is going as it embraces the broad road.